It's that time again for the hottest hour on AM radio. You're tuned in to Carolina Catholic Radio Charlotte 1270 AM, also streaming at CarolinaCatholicMedia.org and on the Carolina Catholic Media app. It's Faith and Sport Time coming to you every Monday at this time. I'm the producer, Chris, and joined in the studio today with the one, the only, your host each week for Faith and Sport, Dr. John Acquaviva.
Welcome, folks, to the show, Faith and Sport, where we apply our faith to all aspects of sport. So if you're a fan, if you're a parent of a fan, if you're a grandparent of a fan, if you're a referee, however you're involved in sport, this is a show for you. It's a sports show, but it's where we tie in character, morality, and ethics as part of that conversation. So welcome either way. Carolina Catholic Radio, it's a co-production of Radio Maria. Here's what we're going to do today. Talk sports with, including our hit and miss, with Ed Billick. He's going to join us in just 1 minute here in the studio. We're going to do this week's headlines. We're going to continue our discussion in the second half with Ed on today's sports stories. We're going to do the quick Q&A with Dr. A. And throughout, folks, we're going to do something for the first time. We're going to carry this on at least one more show. Ed and I have decided to bring you funny sports stories or jokes. They all have to do with the world of sport, and we're just going to try to put a little smile on your face. Are you going to laugh out loud? Doubt it, but you might just put a smile on your face and just make your day a little better. Either way, folks, welcome to the show, Faith and Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Sitting right beside me, my longtime friend, longtime co-host of the show, Ed Billick. Happy Easter, brother.
Well, happy Easter, because the resurrected Christ lives forever, so absolutely, you can say that all the
That's
time.
That's right. We could say that.
If there wasn't an Easter, there'd be no Christmas.
That's right. In fact, a buddy of mine says to everybody he meets for the first time, he'll go, happy birthday, by the way. And they're like, today's not my birthday. And he goes, but you had one this year, right? So it's the same thing. This is a year-round celebration. It really is. But, brother, this is the best time in the liturgical calendar. And you know one of the reasons why? I mean, this is a powerful time, right? Easter's powerful. It's fulfillment of Christ's birth, right? I think the passion, the death of our Lord, the resurrection is the most powerful part. Of course, I'm not saying this for the first time. I'm not the first person to say this. But one of my favorite things is this is the only time of year where the second reading or the first reading does not come from the Old Testament.
Well, you know why? Because the apostles now have witnessed the risen Christ, and they're about to go out and convince the world.
That's right.
And all the trials and tribulations, whether it be on the road to Damascus, I guess as you say, and Christ appeared, but they're trying to convince others of what they just saw and believe. Isn't that our job as well?
It is our job, brother. In fact, I want to talk about that for the first couple minutes. You and I are going to do our hit and miss. We've got a lot of stuff to talk through. There's so much going on in the world of sport as it deals with character, ethics, and morality. But we're going to come back to that, and I think it's worth talking about this. One of the books, in fact, I made myself sound like a really big reader there for a second because I was about to start that sentence with one of the books that I read regularly. But actually, there are two books I'm reading. One's on World War II about the Greatest Generation written by Tom Brokaw that came out a few years ago.
Familiar with it, yes.
Yeah. And this other book is written by Bishop Fulton Sheen called The Life of Christ. And Chris, you can even testify to this. That's a thick book. It's thicker than your regular Dr. Seuss book. Would you agree?
Yes.
So I think.
Anyway, but how many pictures does it have in it?
That's just it. Not many pictures at all.
Well, Chris, what year are there, John? What year was it published? Because that thing looks like it came out of your grandparents' house.
Yeah.
In fact, I think it did. This is a gift from my mom, from her library.
Wow.
Yeah, it came out in 1944.
Wow.
I don't know. This is great.
And the name of the book is, again?
The Life of Christ.
Okay.
So I'm reading about the resurrection this past week, right? Just reflecting on everything that's happened liturgically with us. And this chapter is called The Earth's Most Serious Wound, The Empty Tomb. And I want to get back to our conversation on the Acts of the Apostles. But this is the first part of that first paragraph in this chapter, The Empty Tomb. In the history of the world, only one tomb has ever had a rock rolled before it and a soldier guard set to watch it to prevent the dead man from rising. That was the tomb of Christ on the evening of Friday called Good. What spectacle could be more ridiculous than have armed soldiers keeping their eyes on a corpse? But sentinels were set, lest the dead walk, the silent speak, and the pierced heart quicken to throb of life. They said he was dead. They knew he was dead. They would say he would not rise again, and yet they watched. And that's what leads us to the Acts.
here's one of the things, and this is going to be an encouragement, Ed. I know there's a lot of people that go to church every Sunday, right? Catholics or not, they're Christians, they go to church, but they struggle with their belief, and they struggle with their belief in God. They struggle, in particular, this time of year, with the fact that a man rose from the dead. Now, granted, we know him as Christ. He was fully human, yet fully divine. And people struggle with that, right? And I think this time of year, like, it deepens my faith, and as it probably does yours, but I think in other people's lives, it weakens their faith because they're like, well, how could this person do this, right? It's miraculous, right? And it's part of the mysterious nature of our Lord. And whenever I hear these or read the stories from the Acts of the Apostles, it makes me think they would not have done this for a lie. It's one thing for them to experience what they did, but it's another thing, if they didn't experience the risen Christ, would they have gone out and do what they did?
Every one of the 12 apostles, except John, were martyred for what they believed. Now, if someone's going to burn hot oil over you or getting ready to chop your head off, no, I was just kidding. I don't believe anything. They go to their graves with this belief. Now, why didn't John? Well, John was older. They took him to the island of Patmos or whatever, however you ever say that. And he lived a long life there.
And he took care of Jesus' mom, right?
So for some reason, but the rest of them, they all died for something that they truly believed in. And they were all martyred for that.
That's amazing. The whole thing is amazing. I think it's reason to pay particular attention to the first reading throughout the Easter season, for the next couple of weeks, in fact. But that's what I encourage our listeners who are struggling with their faith to reflect on today and to pray on in their prayer life, is even just a reflection of why would these people do this?
Yeah, absolutely. It's beautiful.
It is, brother. Anyway, folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. It's a co-production of Radio Maria. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. I teach exercise science at nearby Wingate University, just outside of Charlotte here. Joined today by Ed Billick. He's sitting right next to me here in the studio on North Tryon Street. I just like to say it. They always say that, and we never know where any of these studios are, but it makes it sound like it really exists.
This building has a lot of history.
It has a great history.
It's been in radio since 1976, probably the year you were born.
It was a decade before. Thank you for thinking I'm in my 40s. There you go. I appreciate that.
Dr. John Acquaviva and Chris Pressler, who's an Atlanta Braves fan.
That's right.
And he's always has his sports apparel on. And you guys have been doing... Chris, you've been with this team now for, what, a couple of years, right?
With the Carolina Catholic team. I've been with them from the start since 2018.
Yeah, I know, because
it's 4 years now.
When we pulled in, Chris, Ed said, when we pulled him right into the parking lot, he says, Bo, how long have we been coming here? And I said to him, I think it's been 4 years now.
Yeah.
Carolina Catholic Radio, back on AM 1270.
That's right.
But like I've always said, I love listening to it on the internet. It comes through loud and clear, Bluetooth to your phone, and there's just quality programming here Carolina Catholic Radio.
And from what I understand, we had a meeting the other night,
right,
about this pledge coming up. So folks, get your ears ready for that, because I know that can be a challenge when you want to listen to just regular kind of
programming.
Regular program. It's going to be interrupted by some pledge drives we're going to have, but we were organizing this whole thing the other day. And one of the things that David, our CEO, mentioned, David Papandrea, was that the high percentage of local shows that we have on compared to other Catholic radio stations. Do you remember what that percentage was?
Not off the top of my head, but it was a large percentage.
It was a good percentage.
Yeah.
He was proud of it, obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
it's one of the top ones.
Yeah. And we think, and he thinks, it's one of the reasons why our listenership is going to grow stronger, because people can hear local voices.
Usually on radio, folks, you'd rather not ask a question that you really don't know the answer. You don't want to put somebody on the spot. But Chris, you publish every day. There are pastors around the churches here in the diocese that you can listen to some of their sermons, correct?
That's right.
Tell us about that, seriously.
That's right. We have a hour, well, actually it's a half hour from 4 to 4:30 every day, called the Clergy Corner, and I feature homilies from all the pastors around the Charlotte Diocese. I mean, we have at least two homilies per day that I air on there.
And I tell you what, the homilies, I love good homilies.
Oh, yeah,
so from 4 to 4:30 right here on Carolina Catholic Radio.
That's right.
That's
and if you miss them, you can catch them on our website, because I post them to the website too on the Clergy Corner section.
It's perfect.
With their picture and the audio there and a little description of what the homily is about.
Very good.
So during your hour of prayer, however long, or you just need an uplift, it's a great way to go and get spiritually enlightened.
That's right. I appreciate that. Thank you for everything you do, brother, for Carolina Catholic Radio.
Well, I'm glad to do it.
All right, buddy, one of the things that you and I do each and every time is we do our hit and miss in the world of sport, and this is something that is positive or negative through our own lens. As always, you get to go first. Do you have a hit or miss for us?
Well, I don't have either hit or a miss. That's something worthy of this show. But the Pittsburgh Penguins, their on-again, off-again playoff performance against the Rangers has me hitting and missing. The Carolina Panthers draft they did just a week and a half ago got me a couple hits and a couple misses. Or the Hornets' mistake of firing coach James Borrego. I think that was a miss. I think they're going to regret that. And then Max Homa, who won the Wells Fargo championship. It's his second Wells Fargo. Was that a hit for him? Yeah. It's a miss for all the other guys like Jason Day that really
I don't know. Those guys
got up some chunks. But so there's hits and misses, so I can't decide which one which.
Actually, Chris, I think we could have called that Ed's headlines, right?
Yeah.
Ed's headlines. Say that 10 times and don't mess that up. By the way, folks, we have my headlines coming up toward the end of the first half hour, but there's no actual hit or miss this week.
It's just all hits and misses.
Okay.
Or you actually could have called it Edlines.
Edlines. Very good.
Yuck.
Yeah, very good. So mine is a hit. This is tremendous. It came across my desk. I was actually searching for something else. And I came across this great story of a basketball player in the NBA who was born and raised in the Congo. And his name is Bismack Biyombo. And what
he was drafted by the Bobcats originally.
Oh, was he really?
Well, yeah, okay. I had a hard time pronouncing that name, Bismack Biyombo. I got to know.
That's okay, right. No, you're right.
He came back and played for the Hornets, but he's somebody else. Now, go
ahead. I do remember him playing for the Hornets. Anyway, he took off last year partly because of COVID. I think that might have been the main reason. And he came back this year, and he plays for the Phoenix Suns. And his, to make this clear, his salary is $1.3 million. And what he decided to do, actually, the reason he took off that last season was in part to take care of his sick dad. So I'm reading that here. I brought that up just as I was chatting there. So just to be clear on that. Anyway, he signed this contract with the Phoenix Suns. And what he is going to do with this $1.3 million is help build a hospital and actually fund a hospital with medical supplies, not just in that hospital that was taking care of his dad, but all over the country of Congo.
That's special.
I've never heard somebody giving away their entire salary. I've heard people give away even small chunks of it, or even what I would say a large chunk of it, like 10%, because that's pretty big, because we know we're supposed to tithe, right? 10% of our income should go to the church or somebody in need or something that is in need of our donation. But 10% to a major basketball or other pro athlete is a whole lot of money, but he went above and beyond all of that. And he's going to give his full $1.3
million. That's a golf clap for
Bismack. Oh, that is outstanding. Good for him. In fact, you know what's interesting about this story is there's another gentleman from the Congo that you probably know of as well, is Dikembe Mutombo. He's also from the Congo, and he donated $2 million of his NBA earnings toward the building of a hospital medical center in his hometown of Kinshasa, Congo in 1998.
Those guys have great hearts.
They were raised the right way. God bless them. Folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva, joined in studio today with Ed Billick, or by Ed Billick. And that comes to the end of our first segment here. Stay tuned, folks. We're going to come right back with more Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio and Radio Maria.
Carolina Catholic News. Quo Vadis Days. Where are you going? Belmont Abbey College is once again offering a 5-day vocation discernment camp for young men June 14th to June 18th. This retreat challenges men ages 15 through 19 to find out what God's will has for their life. A well-balanced program awaits participants, which includes summer camp activities and fellowship, as well as Mass, Liturgy of the Hours, Eucharistic Adoration, and an interaction with priests and seminarians. The cost for this exceptional event is $150, which includes lodging at the college, meals, and supplies. Financial assistance may be available. Registration has begun. For details, contact Father Brian Becker at bjbecker@charlottediocese.org. For the Carolina Catholic News, I'm Pam Cullen. God bless y'all.
Do you have a desire to conform your life more closely to Jesus Christ? Are you longing for a richer, deeper spiritual life while living in the world? Do you want greater spiritual discipline? Do you want to walk along a well-trod path of sanctification and holiness? Would you like to be part of a religious order that has a strong devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary? Would you like to dedicate your life to liturgical and contemplative prayer and the study of sacred truth, sharing the fruits thereof with others? Do you find within you a holy zeal to fight for truth and justice? Do you have a strong desire for the salvation of souls, to take them by the hand and teach them? Do you want to join the Church's mission of preaching the truth of Christ as He revealed to His holy Church? If all this sounds like you, we invite you to contact the Charlotte Lay Dominicans at our website, charlottelaydominicans.org. That's charlottelaydominicans.org. We look forward to meeting you.
Hey, folks, welcome back to Faith and Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva, joined here by Ed Billick. And in the beginning of the show, I did the little rundown, and I said, here's what we're going to do today, hit and miss, weekend's headlines, and quick Q&A with Dr. A. But I said throughout, Ed and I came up with and researched some funny stories or jokes that either came from athletes or people involved in sport and somehow. So we're going to shoot a couple at you right now. We're going to do this a couple times throughout the show. What's yours, brother?
Well, Joe Theismann, the quarterback for the Washington Redskins.
Of course.
He had a verbal gaffe. He said, nobody in football should be called a genius. A genius is a guy like Norman Einstein. It's Albert Joe.
Albert Joe. That's right. In fact, a lot of people just heard that and go, what's wrong with that? I know Norman Einstein.
And then, of course, Yogi Berra. We all love him, and there's a yogiism.
That's
and here's
right.
one of my favorites.
Let's hear it.
His wife said, Yogi, when he was getting up in age, he goes, listen, you were born in New York. No, you're born in St. Louis, Yogi.
That's right.
You played baseball in New York. We're living here in Florida now. Where do you want to be buried when you die? He goes, surprise me.
I love it. All right, mine's about Yankees as well. This is Mickey Mantle told this story in this interview a few years before he died. I'll never forget this story. So him and his buddies, Whitey Ford, I think Billy Martin were there. And oh, yeah, they might have been had a pop or two. And they go out to this farm, and Mickey is good friends, longtime good friends with the owner of this farm. And so they pull up. They have their hunting gear. They have their hunting rifles. And they're about to get out and hunt. They're like, come on, Mick, let's just go out. And he goes, no, I haven't seen this guy in a while. I just want to remind him we're coming. I'll be right back. So he comes back after talking to the guy, in which he said, okay. But Mickey goes, I want to play a prank on Whitey and Billy, right? So he just makes up the story, and he starts acting all mad. And they're like, what's wrong, Mickey? And he said, I can't believe it. He said he's not going to let us hunt today, and we can't hunt forever on his land anymore. And he goes, that's it. I'm going to go into the barn, because the guy told him, listen, I'll let you guys hunt, but I love that old mule out there, and that mule's dying. You got to kill that mule for me. So Mick agreed to it, right? So he goes, listen, I'm going to go kill that mule in the barn. I'm going to get back at this guy for not letting us hunt on his farm today. So the other two guys are standing outside the barn, and they hear, boom, because Mickey kills as a favor to his friend, this old mule. Then Mickey hears, boom, 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 boom. He runs out there. He looks at those two guys. He goes, what just happened? Whitey Ford looked at him. He goes, oh, we got a couple of his cows, too. Good one, huh? All right, brother, listen, on a more serious note, this has been something that, and I mean this, you are, there's no facetiousness in here. There's no exaggeration. I see you as a wise man. You often bring wisdom when we're talking about faith or whatever we're talking about. I cannot figure out what's going on in NCAA basketball between the men's and the women's. And then the WNBA players and the NBA players, right? W stands for women, the Women's Professional League. Listen to this. I've come across some data on the pay disparity between the two, right? And in particular, the WNBA
and the NBA, right? Now, they have only a little bit in common other than the fact that they play the same sport. And what I mean is this. The NBA is 75 years old. The WNBA is 25 years old. The WNBA is 50 years behind in building its brand, working out labor issues, and so forth. But they are on the constant complaint and demand to making the playing field more level. Now, keep this in mind, too. The average attendance of an NBA game is over 17,000. WNBA, around 6,500. The NBA Finals averaged over 20 million viewers per game. The WNBA Finals of 2 years ago, right when pandemic hit, 400,000 viewers per game. 20 million versus less than 500,000. And they want equal shared revenue. The NBA gets 50, the women get 20. That sounds like a viable option, Ed, only if you are actually bringing in money. They lose so much money, the WNBA does. The only way that they can sustain themselves is by the $12 million a year
stipend. What do you call it?
I think it was called an allowance by the NBA to keep the WNBA afloat. And just last year, they got pay raises of 53%. So basically, this is asking me, if I am the owner of a business and you're my dad or you're my uncle, you're my friend, and you're funding this business, and I say, listen, we took great losses last year, Ed, but I'd like to get a raise as the owner of this company. Wouldn't it be, I don't know, understandable for you to say, well, show me some profit first? They're not making any profit.
From a business standpoint, there's got to be some kind of graph that says they will continue to grow this brand. At a certain point, it'll be able to sustain on itself.
Maybe.
I don't know. This is a market-based economy, right? It is. It's the way we operate. Okay, so if the product is well worth it, people are going to buy tickets to go see concerts, theater plays, sporting events, no difference. But for them to constantly subsidize this other brand, I could think who I worked for before. Eventually, if you bring out a new Dorito or Frito or some kind of corn chip, and then it's not going to sell, you cut the brand because you're going to cut your losses. So somewhere along the line, those in the powers to be, and it's a private business. Yeah. It isn't owned by anybody. It's them.
That's right.
And the ticket people that go buy it and the sponsorship, it'll be interesting how long this lasts.
It will be interesting. I think the problem is this. I think the NBA sees it as their problem because they attach themselves at the hip. The day that
it is a basketball association. It's the national and the women's.
Yeah, and as soon as they did that, they made the commitment to help it succeed. Now, here's the argument you could have: isn't 25 years enough for you to show that you can be sustainable and that you can actually generate revenue and you can get TV viewership up and you can get weekly and daily attendance up? I think that's a lot of time. This is one of those things where I really believe it's not going to be looked at seriously, and nobody's even going to bat an eye because of this lifelong makeup that we're doing toward the lesser in our society.
Yeah. And then I just go back to the business point, too. So as long as the NBA is extremely, extremely profitable. Okay.
Then what's the problem?
Yeah, what's the problem? And let's continue to help this. I don't know how we're running on the segment here. The Charlotte Knights,
yeah,
AAA of the Chicago White Sox, they are affiliated. Does the White Sox help them in any way? I think there's a little bit of help, but they run that show on their own.
Yes.
They're based on their own ticket revenue.
Right.
They have no television rights
right.
that help them. So, yeah, we're part of you, but you got to fly on your own. I think eventually the WNBA is going to have to fly on their own.
You know,
that's interesting, the attendance and all. Viewership, my Lord.
Oh, yeah. There's no comparison. And I mentioned in the beginning of this that one of the parts of that conversation, and really it's two separate conversations, but I'm just as equally interested in and mystified by are the men's and women's basketball tournament and basketball teams and how much money they generate. Just to put this in perspective, for the NCAA tournament alone, the net gain for the men's team or the net amount of money that was garnished through the men's tournament was $865 million. The women was $28 million. So they generated that much. But the women lost $2.8 million overall. In other words, they generated a lot of money through that tournament. But the fact is each one of those teams, Ed, is, you probably know this, right? Nobody just travels down the street to play. They go to like these neutral sites in the region. So you have hotel stay, you have plane travel or bus travel, you have amenities, and you have, of course, food that you have to supply them with. And you don't just have the team, right? You have a staff of coaches and so forth. It's really amazing, and it's the same thing. Because it's the counterpart of the men who make so much, I think the women are, that's why they said, we want the same facilities as the men. And I say, yeah, I understand that you want equality, but the fact is, or they want equity, but the fact is they've been given equality. They've been given the opportunity, and people just aren't watching. In both cases, Ed, the men's tournament versus the women's tournament, in the NBA versus the WNBA, neither the WNBA or women's basketball is new. They've been doing this for decades. They've had the opportunity. And I know this is just something that's accepted, and I think it's possible that some people are looking at me through a certain lens on this matter, but it's more mystifying. I'm looking for answers. I'm not necessarily judging it, but what we do know are these numbers that are in front of us, and it doesn't make much sense to me.
There's also the brand recognition. Can you name the five all-stars on the WNBA team? So no, you're not following them.
No, but Chris can. There's no. I mean, the look on his face he knows their middle names.
My point being, there's no brand definition there, and you know, I'd rather spend my money on going out to dinner. You know, versus it's always where we want to spend our money. And you're going to another point, too. I'm surprised how our Charlotte Football Club soccer team is doing so well here.
Yeah, overall, it's doing pretty well.
Because people only have X amount of dollars they spend on entertainment.
That's right.
So by adding things like that, that diminishes the ability for some of these lesser leagues to make it big.
There you go. All right, brother. Everybody, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria.
Yeah, how about those folks, huh?
How about who folks?
The Radio Maria
folks. I know, they're fantastic. I love those people.
How many stations on Radio Maria Network?
There's, I think, 12 total in six different states. And then so we make seventh state and 12 different stations.
Carolina Catholic Radio, Carolina, folks. We're all over the place here,
I know,
with this show.
Actually, this is Carolina Catholic Radio, mm-hmm. but really the whole thing now is called Carolina Catholic
Media. Yeah.
Media, yeah.
Because it's much more than radio.
That's right. And as far as Faith and Sport is concerned, we're nationally syndicated.
There you go. We can say that. I love saying that. Either way, folks, we're happy that you joined us today. We're hoping that you're having a good Easter.
We're having fun here.
And Ed and I are throwing every once in a while a joke or a little quip or a story about an athlete or something that an athlete said. So you're first. What's your
favorite guy that I know? He was a basketball general manager. He's also part owner of the Orlando Magic. His name's Pat Williams. And he made light of his team's struggles recently. He says, we can't win at home. We can't win on the road. As a general manager, I just got to figure out where else to play.
There you go. Mine's a little more simple. It has to do with our aforementioned Yogi Berra, who said, Little League is a very good thing because it keeps the parents off the streets.
Yeah, it sure does.
And anybody who's been to a Little League game knows exactly what we're talking about.
Well, we're talking faith and sport and behavior in those Little League games. That's another whole topic, John, that you talk.
Here's another one. Anyone who thinks women talk too much has never sat through a six-hour Super Bowl pregame show.
Oh, jeez. Hey, Coach.
Chris, there's something to be said about that, isn't
yeah.
there?
Legendary Coach Vince Lombardi said the only place success comes before work is in the dictionary.
There you go.
Ding, ding.
So, folks, we're going to get in just a minute to our weekend headlines. But one of the things I want to mention, which this drove me crazy. This is one of those many things about how baseball is slighted and football is always elevated. You recall about 10 days ago now, in fact, it was just last weekend, Miguel Cabrera got his 3,000th hit.
And you're a big Detroit Tiger fan.
Of course,
I know you are.
I know.
Miggy.
I know, but the thing was, is he's still the 33rd player to ever do it. And then upon that 3,000th hit, because he already had 500 doubles, there's only seven guys in the history of baseball, brother,
that
have 500 doubles and 3,000 hits.
Yeah.
So about 2 hours after he did this, I was going to my daughter's to pick her up for softball practice, right? And I get in and I turn, it's exactly 4 o'clock, and I turn on the radio and it's an ESPN show. It's coming on. The music's coming on. They're like, ladies and gentlemen, the host of your show, you know, Bill Stevens. And Bill Stevens comes on. He goes, folks, I have breaking news to share with you. And I go, good. He's going to talk about Miguel Cabrera, one of my favorite Tigers of all time. He says, the draft is 5 days away. He didn't start with anything about Miguel Cabrera. The first thing he said on the day Miguel Cabrera got his 3,000th hit is, folks, the NFL draft.
And they will be the first ones to say that baseball's losing viewership. Well,
yeah.
Hello.
I wonder how.
I wonder why.
All right, folks, this week's headlines. Chris, you got some music for us. All right, Major League Baseball, speaking of, it's still early, but some teams are starting to separate themselves. Teams that were expected to be bad and are the Pirates, the A's, and the Tigers. Sorry, buddy, two of those three teams are ours. And the teams expected to be real good and are the Mets, Yankees, and the Dodgers. The biggest surprise, Chris's World Series champs, Atlanta Braves, that are two games under 500. Yeah. But you're still striking, you know what I mean? Like the Tigers are 10, 12 games under 500.
Yeah, and I hope our founder, David Pandrea, is listening, because tomorrow the Braves start a two-game series with his Boston Red Sox.
There you go.
We'll see how that one goes.
Yeah, we'll see. In the Kentucky Derby, it was raced this past weekend. The winner was an 80-1 long shot, Rich Strike. That morning of the race, this horse was not even in the field, but a withdrawal from another horse, Rich Strike, sneaks in. Amazingly, this was not the longest odds to ever win this race. Donna Rail in 1913 was 91-1 and won that year's race. Thus, this weekend's race gave us a lot of interesting and amazing stories. The NHL, we're in the first round of the playoffs and no team is yet to advance. Yet one of the best NHL regular season records belonged to the Colorado Avalanche, and they're up 3-0 in their series, so it looks like they're moving on. Either way, lots to keep an eye on there, including Ed's Pittsburgh Penguins. You excited, buddy?
I'm nervous.
Nervous?
It's going to be a hit or a miss.
I want you to be excited. Anyway, so there you have it, folks. Sports news that may or may not change your life. Listen, we're going to go to a break now. Stay with us for the second half of Faith and Sport.
Faith and Sport.
Ed will be back right after this.
Yeah, baby.
My name is Ray Haywood, and I'm coming to you today to speak to you about the fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group, a men's group that was started under the leadership of Father Matthew Carr by the intentional men of the parish of St. Thomas Aquinas here in our diocese of Charlotte, North Carolina. In our first efforts, we were asked if we would model our men's group in a way that other parishes could simply follow. With that intent in mind, we created the FSJJourneyman.com website. On that website, you can find all that is needed to create your own chapter of the Fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group in your parish, as well as resource documents that we are intentionally placing into our faith community. We hope that you will step closer to the path and to each other in the just model of St. Joseph as you consider creating your own chapter of the Fraternity of St. Joseph Men's Group.
. 2022 is bringing many new and exciting changes to our Carolina Catholic Apostolate, built to communicate how to better learn, love, and live our Catholic faith. We begin with our name change to Carolina Catholic Media. This reflects the expanded scope of Carolina Catholic Radio to include the development of our podcast, streaming, social media, YouTube, and direct marketing platforms. 2022 is a very important year for the Catholic Church. As a result, Carolina Catholic Media will feature more local news, information, and conversation to reflect what's happening now and how it impacts our local Catholic community. Throughout the year, Carolina Catholic Media will showcase our Catholic schools and homeschools, the Charlotte Diocese 50th anniversary, and the two-year worldwide synod process that begins on the diocesan level. We encourage you to get involved, join us, and catch the spirit. The Carolina Catholic Media Apostolate is a 501c3 nonprofit. We are 100% funded by you. Please consider a donation, monthly tithe, or business sponsorship to support our mission and vision to spread the truth of Jesus Christ and our Catholic faith across the Carolinas. Thank you for discerning a role in our apostolate. May God bless you abundantly.
that cowbell?
More cowbell. You know what I'm talking about. More cowbell. Hey, folks, welcome back to Faith in Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva, joined in studio by Ed Billick. Buddy, thank you for being here. I appreciate this. I always enjoy it a little more when we're doing stuff.
Like my buddy Doc Rivers says, winning is like deodorant. When it comes up, a lot of things just don't stink. I don't know if that makes you laugh or not. Trying to have some fun here on Faith in Sport.
We are trying to have some fun. So let's stay along this line. We were talking about women's sports and basketball, both in the NBA and the WNBA. And I thought this was really interesting comment or commentary on the NIL, the name, image, and likeness. And I really don't know where to take this. I just thought this was interesting.
Tell our listeners, who many of them may not be heavy into sports, right, what is that?
It's the name, image, and likeness policy that the NCAA adopted a year ago right now. In fact, it was actually maybe around a little later on in the summer, maybe June or July, in which they said a college athlete now can go to a university and play for a university in which they pay them for a variety of things, including using their name, image, and
likeness.
They? So the NCAA is, this is the way the NCAA would allow for college players to be paid. So if a college player is on a team, say the University of Nebraska, and they are particularly good at their position.
You got to be good.
Got to be good. In general, you have to be good. And maybe they have some other qualities, like they're attractive or they're really funny, whatever the
good
case
speaker
is.
Speaker like you.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Because you could have been a rugby.
I could have been, yeah, I could have been rugby nil. And what this allows, of course, it doesn't guarantee them money, but it allows them the chance to sign contracts with organizations. And sometimes their face is just on a billboard, they're on a commercial, they can do autograph sessions. So there's a lot of different ways that they can earn money, and it's unlimited. And so now that we're 1 year into it, some information, right, some stats have come out about.
This ought to be interesting.
Yeah. So the most nil compensation by sport, and again, nil is name, image, and likeness.
That I could sell my name, I could sell my image, right, I could sell my likeness to an outside firm, not the school, and they'll pay me for it. Okay.
So needless to say, football is 55% of all of the nil monies go to the gentleman that plays football.
Surprise, right?
13% men's basketball. So basically what we're talking about, if we add those up, that is 70% minus half of a percentage.
So football majority, basketball
is the next. But listen to this. The next three sports, women's volleyball, women's basketball, women's swimming and diving, and then men's swimming and diving, and then softball. So of the top seven, four are women's sports. I don't think a lot of people
expected
that.
So they're not promoting their women as well as they are. The local businesses are not grabbing these athletes and wanting to promote women.
But the other way to look at that is women's volleyball is third at almost 7%. Women's basketball is fourth at almost 5% and so forth. But by the way, if you add up all the other teams and their percentage, of course, it doesn't get anywhere near the 70% of men's basketball and football.
How about baseball?
Baseball is number 10. 1% of all nil money goes to men's baseball.
So they're not hyping up their baseball players. They're hyping up their players. These are businesses. This isn't the school.
Well, brother, what I would say that it's not that they're not hyping up those schools. It's that those institutions, the players at those institutions are being attracted with money by organizations that want them for perhaps more than the popularity of their sport or even the popularity of that individual.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, yeah, that's interesting.
Because if you, okay, hang with me here on the analogy. Do you remember Maria Sharapova?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Tennis player.
Yeah. So she was known for being particularly attractive, right? And if I remember Sharapova, right, the Russian tennis player, if I remember correctly, she was at the top of money winners, but what she actually made more of, though, or at least almost as much of, was no money, right? Using her name,
image. For commercials, advertisements.
Yeah. And there was that other gal. Her name is eluding me. She never won a major title. She dated. In fact, she was known for dating the great Russian hockey player for the Red Wings. And I'm forgetting her name. but she never won a major tournament, but she made more money than anybody else on the tour because of how pretty she was.
Yeah.
And people knew who she was by not just her name, but
they
how
knew her image. They knew her image.
And I think that's, in a way, what's going on here. It's possible, but I don't know. There's probably something to that. Because, for instance, I saw this article about this gal from the University of Nebraska volleyball team who was talking about her NIL, her name, image, and likeness contract. And the first thing you happen to notice about her is she was very pretty.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably standard. But I also know that's standard for guys. I mean, it would. Tom Brady's great. Tom Brady has made tens of millions of dollars on endorsements. If he didn't look the way he looked, would he be Tom Brady, the marketer, right? Would he be Tom Brady, the guy who garnishes a lot of money for any commercial he does? I don't think so. I think you would have to agree with that. Whether you, like, my wife even says something like, yeah, he's, you know, I'm not sure I'd necessarily look at him twice because the my type, not my type thing. But she fully admits with every other woman out there that he's a really attractive
guy.
Are
those charisma attributes, those physical attributes, gifts from God, and God's looking on how those people use that to benefit others, like your earlier piece in the prior segment with Dikembe Mutombo and Bismarck Biyombo?
Yep.
Is that some of the thing? I mean, God gives you gifts and how you use them. So
I
just go back to the physical beauty that some people have, and that's, you know, it's interesting, though. But those statistics are amazing. It's all football and basketball, isn't it?
70% of it is. That's where the money goes. And of course,
after 1 year.
Yeah. And there was no surprise there. Anybody probably would have predicted that. If you asked me, I said it would have been probably closer to 80 or even 85% because those are the ones that are on TV. Yes, you can turn on ESPN3 and watch Auburn versus Alabama softball. Yes, you can turn on in the fall, you know, men's Division III football. But the people that we recognize the name of, people that we recognize the face of, are the people that play Division I football and Division I basketball.
You can name the Heisman Trophy candidates and the one who won the Heisman Trophy this year, but you can't name any of the baseball all-star baseball players going to the College World Series later.
No.
It's the way it's marketed.
You're also talking about Sharapova. Well, you probably noticed that a lot of commercials now feature Serena Williams, like Subway and DirecTV. She's been in a lot of their commercials.
Oh, yeah. She's a powerful figure. And notice that she, although she is a better tennis player than her sister Venus, but she has elevated herself. I think Venus has probably been on about one-tenth of all the commercials.
I'm going to go to Subway and get a sub because of Venus Williams.
Yeah, I mean,
Serena, you mean?
Serena, yeah,
I mean,
Venus.
I see Subway's commercials. I'm like, man, they must have some serious advertising bucks there because you see Serena Williams on there, Tom Brady, Seth Curry.
Oh, yeah.
We got a little Geico at home because he's on TV so much. We thought we'd get a Geico as a pet.
What? It's a gecko. I think he works
gecko,
for
Geico. Gecko, Serena, whatever. Okay.
All right, brother. So your turn again. What do you got for us as far as a funny story or actual joke?
I don't know. Chamberlain said, they say that nobody is perfect. Then they tell you to practice makes you perfect. Wish they'd make up their minds.
Ah, there you go. That's right. So mine is another story. It has to do with the Yankees. Do you remember the famous book? In fact, I would contend this is the most famous book on any sport. It's called Ball Four by Jim Belfort.
Well, when that came out, I was old enough to remember.
Jim Bouton, I said.
Jim Bouton. Yeah. He pulled a lot of people under the rug there.
He did. He got a lot of people upset. Yeah. And speaking of the bus, brother, there was one time, and remember, this is during the 1960s. The heyday for the New York Yankees was really the decades prior to that. In the 1960s, they started to be very average. In the 1960s, they had Jim Bouton playing for them, but also it was toward the end of his career was Mickey Mantle. Right?
Absolutely, yeah.
They were in the midst of a long losing streak, and I think it was 8 games at this time. And the manager was the last one to get on the bus. And the way Jim Bouton told it, he didn't even want to get on the bus. He's probably frustrated with the players. He's just frustrated managing this team. They're just not winning. And he says before the manager gets on the bus, one of the utility players pulls out his harmonica and he starts playing it, right? And, of course, harmonica is kind of like a – you know, can be kind of a peppy thing. And either way, music at this point probably wouldn't have been encouraged, right?
That would be more like the blues.
Yeah, that's right. He should have been. I mean, but clearly Bouton's like, No, everybody should at this point just be silent, right? We lost our eighth game in a row. Everybody be quiet. Instead, because the manager's off the bus, this utility player takes out his harmonica and he starts playing the harmonica. And he starts getting into it so much he doesn't realize the manager walks up to the steps of the bus and walks on the steps of the bus and stands right near the steering wheel and turns around. And he goes, "Who in the heck is playing that? Stop that right now." And he took the harmonica away from him, and he turned to Mickey Mantle, and he said, "What'd he say?" And Mickey Mantle goes, "He said he loves it and to play louder."
Edge and Bob Boy, ball four. Oh, man. You know, I've never read it, but now years later, I ought to go pick it up.
Oh, yeah, you would really enjoy it. You'd really enjoy it. Because plus it was from an era in which you were following baseball, you knew baseball, you know these guys and so forth. It is a great read. And I've read a few books on sports, including baseball, but I agree, it's the best book ever written because it was about the insight of baseball, not just about the game on the field. It was about how management works with the team, how the manager works with the team, and so forth. I thought it was awesome.
Hey, there's one here, Al McGuire.
Let's hear it.
He used to also be a CBS analyst. He was in basketball. He was a coach. He said, "Don't call me son unless you're going to include me in your will." He said that to his coach.
I like that.
Yeah.
So on a little more solemn note, it is sad for me to report that one of the best pitchers currently in the game, Trevor Bauer, has been suspended for the next 2 years.
Are you sad because of that?
Well, I'm sad because what he's accused of. Well, we can come back to it, but we got another minute or two before we go to that segment break. But yeah, here's a guy who won – just 2 years ago, the Cy Young.
Sure did, yeah.
With the Cincinnati Reds. He got signed by the L.A. Dodgers. It's one of the reasons they're expected to be the best team in the majors this year. He signed a $102 million three-year contract with the Dodgers. Played last year. He has had some accusations come forward that are obviously serious enough to the DA's office, and in particular to MLB, about assaulting a woman that he had met, and he's been suspended. That's how serious these allegations are, for 2 years. And one of the reasons I bring this up is this is an opportunity whenever we hear about these athletes, even if they play for an opposing team, even if this is a player that we do not care for in any way, that we want to see win, this is still where our Christian faith should rise above all of it. And we need to pray for this person, because when this person and all of us act in more accordance to God's teachings, we have a better and safer society. And that's why it's reason enough, even if you don't like these players, even if you don't like Trevor Bauer, it's still worthy to pray for them. He's in big trouble probably. And if this suspension is held, it's going to be the single biggest penalty financially, I think, not only of any baseball player ever, but any major athlete ever.
You know, we are a failed people, all of us on this earth. We all have our problems, and that's a great point you made. Just because they're professional sports figures, they're not all role models.
No, they're not.
They didn't get there by being good Christian people.
Well, some of them have, but some of them have in the sense of this, that maybe that they used God's power and wisdom to help them work out more, help them work out better, whatever the case is. But I agree that they are there because of their skill primarily and their hard work, and that's where
they just need our prayers.
They do. Folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. It's a co-production of Radio Maria. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. In studio is Ed Billick. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back in a couple minutes.
Hi, this is Gail Buckley Barringer, a.k.a. the Bible Lady. How many times have you been asked questions about your faith, such as where is purgatory in the Bible, or why do Catholics pray to Mary? Wouldn't it be nice to be able to point to these answers right in your Bible? Well, you can. The Catholic Scripture Study Bible has an extra 76 pages of information on our faith, including answers to many questions such as these, with Bible verses under each subject that you can turn to right there in your Bible for the answers. There are several articles as well about dreams in the Bible. the devil, end times, and more. In addition, I compiled a topical and index with many subjects, including gossip, angels, and even tattoos, with Bible verses related to these topics as well. The Catholic Scripture Study Bible is beautiful and would make a great gift for Easter, graduation, weddings, or any occasion. It can be found in bookstores nationwide on the publisher's website as well as Amazon.com.
Hey everybody, Bill Snyder here. I'm one of the co-hosts of The Remnant. It's a men's show on the Carolina Catholic Radio Network with my two friends, Ray Haywood and Stephen Thomas. We talk about some of the issues facing men today and how to fight back against a culture that hates authentic masculinity. You can listen to it on the Carolina Catholic Radio Network every single Saturday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Check it out.
Man, I wanted to let that one keep playing, but we got a show to do. Hey,
me
folks.
Too. I was about to bounce out of my seat listening to it.
You're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Ed Billick's here. What do you got, Ed?
Professionally produced by our one and only Chris Pressler, who picks and chooses all of our ins and outs to make this show very special.
Well, actually, we came up with those together.
Yeah.
Oh, look, he wants credit.
Chris. Okay. I'll split the credit there. But either way, brother, it doesn't matter to me because somebody else made that music, right?
That's right.
It's not like I did.
You're giving kudos to them.
Absolutely.
You're such a giving guy.
Folks, this is Faith and Sport, where we look at sport through a Catholic lens. So thank you for joining us today. This is for the athlete. This is for the parent of the athlete, the grandparent of the athlete, the referee, administrator. However you're involved in sport, this show is for you because it's a regular sports show. We just try to weave in with each and every story we do, character, ethics, and morality. And just sometimes just good old I want to feel good, and I want you folks to feel good about sports.
Today we're throwing a few funnies at you, and there was a sports player, high school sports guy. He says, I went to a Catholic high school in Philadelphia. There was a lot of them there. We had one coach for football and one for basketball. He took us all out and to run through a forest. The ones who ran into the trees were on the football team.
Oh, that was pretty good. I did not see that coming. All right, here's mine, brother. You know Steve Young, right? He's a commentator on ESPN.
He used to play quarterback for the Niners.
That's right. And prior to that,
Tampa Bay.
That's right. Very good. And this was when he was with Tampa Bay. So it's in the middle of the game. In fact, it's in the last few minutes of the game. He's telling the story. I'm reading about this. He's telling the story. It's in quotes, the whole thing. And it's an important part of the game. They have a drive, and they have to score a touchdown to win. They can't get a field goal. They have to get a touchdown to win this game. And in slight break in the action, the head referee comes up to him and says something about, my daughter and you have a lot in common. I think you should consider taking my daughter out. During the game, right? And Steve Young looks at him and he just kind of nods like, how do I even acknowledge that, right? And then a couple minutes later in the game, it's going down to like a couple minutes left. He says something else about his daughter, right? And Steve Young is like, this is unbelievable. I'm trying to win this game. This is an NFL game. I'm trying to win this game. I'm the quarterback of the team. I need all my focus on what's going on in the game.
Versus thinking about what his daughter looks like.
Exactly. Or that do I even care to take any? How does he know I don't have a girlfriend, right? So it's the last drive, and there's, I think, less than a minute remaining at this point. But they're getting close to the goal line at this point. Anyway, he drops back to pass. Kaboom, gets hit, gets separated from the ball. He's trying to get his wits about him. He doesn't know which way's up and everything. Anyway, he's like, he sees the ball laying on the ground. The other team jumps on the ball. He's thinking, we just lost the game, right? We can't win the game now. And he says 5-10 seconds after that, he sees a flag come in between him and the guy from the other team that's jumped on the ball. And he goes, late hit on the defense. First down, Tampa Bay. Anyway, Steve Young gets up, is walking back to the huddle, and he hears that same referee said something about his daughter minutes before say something like, by the way, her favorite food is Italian. Come on, that's great.
That can't be true.
Well, that's what he said. I'm just telling you.
Oh, my gosh.
I got, you know.
How did that story end? Did you ever? We don't know.
It was a joke, Ed. All right. Listen, you know, one of the things I mentioned earlier is that sometimes we our story really doesn't have everything to do with ethics, morality, and character, but sometimes just has to do with us wanting to make the listener feel good about being involved in the world of sport and hearing some things that they wouldn't normally hear about. And this one has to do with what is called the emergency backup goalie. And just to put this in perspective, each team is allowed to have two guys.
National Hockey League?
The National Hockey League. And each major league team, each NHL team, is allowed to have two goalies. And they're full-time goalies. And the third stringer is the same guy for each team. He's called the emergency backup goalie. They often are former minor league players, or they just played in college. And the irony is that they are there, they are to be at each home game. So at each home game, there's one of these guys.
So the team hires this kind of non-professional, yeah, but has experience.
And they probably pay him $50 or just give him a free ticket to be at the game, just with the small chance he might get into the game. And this gentleman that comes, let's see, he's at the Stars and Anaheim Ducks game. This backup goalie's name is Tom Hodges, and he played college hockey at SMU. Needless to say, both goalies for the Anaheim Ducks, they exit the game with injuries. So this guy signs a contract. It's $500, and he gets the jersey he wears. He gets to go into the game. They were losing 3-2.
Okay, the team that he was going to goal for, okay.
Yep, so he's actually out on the ice. And they don't mention how long actually he was sitting in this role. It could have been years before he had this opportunity. Now, by the way, he's not the first guy to do this. Other backup goalies have actually played. And they're not buffoons, right? They're people that have played college hockey or minor league hockey. I doubt if any instance these guys are former NHL goalies, right? They probably wouldn't stoop down to do something like that. Anyway, he came out and he took, I think, they took three shots on him. He stopped two of the three. So he went into the game, and the team was losing. His team, the Ducks, were losing 3-2. They ended up losing 4-2. But what an experience that guy had. He could tell his grandchildren. He could tell his children. He could tell every friend he's ever had, I played in a National Hockey League game in which the score was close on top of it. Isn't that a great story?
I love that. I love that. That's
wonderful.
Great.
All right, bro, you got any more jokes or stories for us?
There's one here. What was this? Oh, yeah. Coach says, our fans never fall asleep at our games because they're afraid they make a hit by a bad pass.
There you go.
I don't know. Folks, go to just Google funny sports quotes.
No, don't do that because then we won't. The next time we do this, they're not going to be able to.
There are so many good ones. You probably got another one there yourself.
All right. There was this NFL player in the 1970s, I think it was. And what he would do, he was a little raucouser party.
Joe DeLamalure?
It wasn't Joe DeLamalure. He was a good family man. Yeah, yep, and he's a friend of the show and friend of this guy here. But this particular guy told the story that what he would do is he said every time he would come home late, he would just lay in the hammock and he'd come in for breakfast in the morning, beat the kids down for breakfast.
Outside on the back porch?
Exactly,
in the yard.
And one time he comes home late and, you know, late in the football season, but it's really late. The sun's already come up and he comes through the front door and she just goes, where were you? And he goes, honey, you know, when I come home after midnight, I just get in the hammock. I sleep there. I come in the morning to try to beat you and the kids up. And she says, honey, I took that hammock down a month ago. And he looked at her and he goes, that's my story and I'm sticking to it. Come on, that's pretty good. All right, folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio, a co-production of Radio Maria. You know, there's one other thing I wanted to mention. Chris, how are we doing on time, brother?
About five more minutes.
Okay, oh, got five more minutes, yeah, to chatter. Okay, do you remember this? It was making some really big headlines, Ed, about the Supreme Court and coaches' prayer.
Yeah.
All right, you heard about
I'm
this.
I'm up on that one.
Okay, so this JV coach, he ended up getting fired from this high school. And in fact, his last name was Kennedy, and he had the first name Joe Kennedy. He had the very first name of the oldest of the Kennedy brothers. And I don't know if he's Catholic or not, but he's certainly of some Christian faith. And he wanted to pray after each and every, I don't think just game, but each and every practice. Anyway, it was such a spectacle, and it became so known and common because it was a public scene. Right after these games, he would bring people near midfield, and a lot of colleges do this.
Well, a lot of them do. Yeah, okay, what's wrong with that?
Well, the difference is those are inspired and led by
players.
The players. In this case, it was led and inspired by the coach. And of course, the argument is, you know, public school coaches should not be allowed to impose their religion on students.
The word's called impose.
Exactly. But his lawyer said, no, this is a we're backing off from the First Amendment and Freedom of Religion Acts and parts of our Constitution. But of course, that's why it's an argument. But in what's interesting about the take I'm going to have right now is that we do have to look at it from the point of the people that are trying to ban public prayer in these particular instances. And that's because of this, Ed. The coach, when he calls everybody to the middle of the field.
Oh, he's calling them.
Well, he's.
These are the questions I would have.
Yes. And he, we don't know exactly. We could have him here on the show and he might say, no, this is purely volunteer, on a volunteer basis. I never bothered anybody. I never asked anybody why they weren't there. But the issue is this, and I think this is what the Supreme Court, and in particular, the people that are against him in this case, their concern is that the unbelieving player from different faiths that don't pray in this manner, or simply the ones
may
that
may become inspired to begin praying and will become Christian.
Well, that's certainly would be the hope of the Christian, right? But the problem is this. It's a very tricky thing, the relationship between the player and any coach. They want to play. And if they're against this, if they're an atheist or agnostic, or this is not part of their faith, like somebody's starting off a prayer with "Dear Jesus Christ," and Jesus Christ isn't their savior, the player feels the obligation to go to the middle of the field, perhaps. And I think, as much as anything, in fairness to it, I know that's part of the case against
the coach. Well, you're a teacher as well as an administrator, so I could see your point of view. I pardon me, because I got to understand it deeper. But yeah, you are right, because people want to follow their leaders. They want to act and behave like their leaders. And or if they do, they may get special privileges like, okay, I'll be able to start the next game.
That's right. Or I want to be able to play more. Or I know next year on the varsity, I'm one of those tweener kids that could be cut. I want to be one of those kids that's not cut. There's a whole lot of things there, Ed, to be considered, right?
Yeah, things we talk about today. It's amazing.
Well,
it's sad, but you know, I think one more time, our Christian faith gets attacked in these kind of manners. It's my opinion, but
no,
but at the same time, if he was a Muslim or an atheist or whatever, you know, would I want my child to be around a person like that?
Yeah, and you
so
know,
I got to put the shoe on the other foot.
No, I understand that, but one of the things that I would say is like, there's some really good pictures of this Joe Kennedy coach, and he's certainly having a time with his. Players, it's quite possible his players love him. It's quite possible his players really appreciate the fact that he prays. But this is a public institution. It's not a Catholic or Christian institution. And this is written in such a way that it kind of indicts him. And I'll just read this one part. For years, Kennedy imposed his religion on football players by reciting team prayers, not only on the field at the 50-yard line after games, but tellingly also in the locker room. And of course, they do use the term imposed his religion. I think that's a little strong, but that's quite possible what that meant. Because the thing is, if they're going to hear this case, they're going to hear such details. They're going to know whether this was imposed or not. Was this purely volunteerism on the part of anybody who participated? This is tricky, but I do like the fact that his heart probably is in the right spot and he wants to bring Christ to people, because that's the one thing about a lot of adults' faith. It's a lot richer, and there's a deeper understanding.
And he has a courage like many of us don't have.
No, that's true. There's a lot of people that if you even ask them to pray before a dinner with a couple families there, they'll turn red in the face. They don't want to do that. And even though they can do that, they know what the words to say and so forth, it's just not part of their personality. And this does take some courage to do this. But this will be interesting the way it plays out. By the way, the thought is that this particular case, it said something like, even though the final decision has been made, that they're leaning toward siding with him. Isn't that interesting?
Interesting.
There you
always
go.
Bring up interesting things here on Faith and Sport. John, it's been a pleasure being with you guys. My once-a-month visit. Chris?
I love it, brother.
Staying out of trouble, keeping making sure John sounds good.
Yes.
There you go.
I do my best. It's a hard job, but somebody's got to do
I
it.
I can see.
In conclusion, Pope Francis said, sport is not only a form of entertainment, but also, and above all, a tool to communicate values that promote the good that is in humans. Again, that's from Pope Francis. Before we go, a special thanks to you, Ed Billick.
It's my pleasure.
Chris, to you. And I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Please join us next time here on Carolina Catholic Radio and Radio Maria for more Faith and Sport. Saint Sebastian,
pray for us.
You've been listening to Faith and Sport on the Carolina Catholic Radio Network, 1270 AM Charlotte. Also streaming at carolinacatholicmedia.org and on the Carolina Catholic Media app. We're also simulcasting with Radio Maria. So thank you to all of our Radio Maria listeners listening around the Radio Maria broadcasting area. And thank you to all of our Carolina Catholic Radio listeners tuned in today as well. And make sure whenever you go to CarolinaCatholicMedia.org or on the Carolina Catholic Media app to hit that Donate Now button to help keep Carolina Catholic Radio on the air and Faith and Sport. We'll meet you back here next week for more Faith and Sport.